Let's see. Yep, but let's go over the theme scripture because we're going to deal with this lesson tonight. We're talking about 139, Psalms 139, 23 and 24. Psalms 139. We thank God for everybody coming out tonight. We want you to open up your heart. Really do some soul searching with yourself. There's just some things God's not going to do. There's some things God's just not going to do, saints. And I'm gonna share a few bit, but this, I remember teaching this, and it's good to always go back over the word. I was saying when I came from church, when I just got saved, here we go. Search me, look. Search me thoroughly, oh God. Do you know what thoroughly means? Turning over every nook and cranny. I mean, going off into every avenue. Places you don't want nobody else to go into. God already know what's there. Search me thoroughly, oh God, and know my heart. He already know. Test me and know my anxious. Why are you anxious? Be anxious for nothing. Take no thought. Everything that we anxious about, that's why I don't get anxious. I know because God knows when you get anxious, you finna jack something up. And see if there is any wicked, twisted, or hurtful way in me. And lead me in the everlasting way. Is that both scriptures? All right. You may be seated. What is God doing here? What is God doing? Who is this talking? Who is the author of this? David. Didn't God know what was in David's heart? Hold on. Didn't God know what was in David's heart? Do we know what's in your heart? Is there any hurtful thing in you? Is that part like Christ? Nope. No, it's not. No, it's not. That part is not like him. Jeremy, put that back up there. Search me thoroughly. Do God really have to search you? Do God really have to search you? What don't God already know about you? Did he know Adam and Eve were going to eat the fruit? Yep. But he still gave them a choice. You have a choice. So let's not use the word mistake here at Kingdom Faith. Because the Bible said a law, your conscience was a law for right and wrong. You knew what was right, and you knew it wasn't no mistake. We were hoping God was going to let it pass, and he was going to okay it. No, God is holy. He ain't changing. The Holy Spirit, search me thoroughly, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. Let's get that again. 24. And see and see if there any wicked or hurtful way in me, and lead me in an everlasting way. So I think by now we know everything that's wrong in our life. Why do we keep flying off with attitude? Why we get smart with people? Was Jesus like that? Okay, aren't we born again? Are we really born again? All right, so we in God's family, right? All right, okay. I'm going to read the thought. As followers of Christ, our spiritual foundation, and follower is a disciple. A disciple. He said, go and make disciples. Do we understand what discipleship is? Amen. As a follower of Christ, our spiritual foundation is vital to our life in Christ, in the anointing. That's Christos. Okay? You got to learn how to follow. I see too many people want to lead somebody and ain't submitted to nobody. God ain't going to trust you with that. You got to submit to somebody. So God, if God is going to use you to be a leader and trust you with dunamis and a usia, you're going to have to submit yourself. Did Jesus do it? Did Jesus go home and subject himself to his parents? The first place where everybody should start off in a home is respecting your parents and submitting to your parents. Then the next place is the school, the principals, the teachers. But we find it hard to submit to anybody. You know, I'm going to say this, and y'all hear me. You know, when people grow up in a home where there's no father, those children grow up being unruly and undisciplined. Because the father is the disciplinarian of the house. And when there ain't no daddy there to keep everything in order, those children grow up, man, girls and boys, rebellious all over the place. This is why we got what we got. God never intended for a woman to raise children by herself. The whole thing is broke down, but who want to be fixed? Okay, if you want to be fixed, search me, Lord. Jeremy, give me one. Go back to one. Psalm 139, let's go to one. So, here go the deal. If this thing going to get fixed, then we got to look at us. Don't look at nobody else. Look at you and find out why you like that. Because a follower is a disciple, a learner, a pupil of Christ. And the Bible said we did not learn Christ like this. Jesus did not act like this. Oh, Lord, you have searched me thoroughly and have known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up my entire life. God know everything that you're going to do from start to finish. And he know how many people going to hell because they chose hell. He know how many people going to be saved. He already know all this. He know where your faith is. He just wants you to know where your faith is. Because if you know something ain't wrong, right in your life and you let it stay like that, you are not a follower because God has spoken to you. The word, when you read the word, that word should tell you and talk directly to you about that. That's God speaking to you. That's God talking to you, and you fail to do something about it. So, are you a believer or are you a doubter? I'm telling you now, you ain't nothing finna happen. You know when I sit down. God know when you sit. He know when you rise up. My entire life, everything I do. You understand my thoughts from afar, even if they jacked up and wrong. He understand why you like that. God is going to scrutinize. He's going to catechize. He's gonna tear down every path and you're lying down. Everything that you do, every road you take, he's going to scrutinize it. He's going to catechize it. Are you and you are intimately acquainted with all my ways? If anybody know you, God know you. This is why, as a man of God, I don't have to do nothing but let God speak to me. Because he gave me the ability to watch over souls. So he know everybody in this church. And I ain't got to do nothing but listen to God. God ain't never lied to me. especially about me. Come on. It says, even before there's a word on my tongue still unspoken, behold, you know it. Whether it's cursing, Jesus didn't curse. God didn't curse. Why you curse? God hates sin. Why you hate just to be hating? See, that's not like your behavior got to match your knowledge. And we don't teach hate. We don't teach cursing or cussing. I did a sermon, a series on how you curse yourself and you cuss people out. And then it comes back to you and hurts you. Because it ain't going to never hurt the people you talking against. It's going to always hurt you. Is that right? Well, I didn't say it, but God saw it. You might as well have said it. You might as well have said it because God saw it written in your heart. And the reason why God said, now, every believer, we got to go back to Ezekiel. And let me finish this out. Jeremy, don't move yet. He said, you have enclosed me behind and before. You have enclosed me behind and before. And you have placed your hand upon me. Such infinite knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is too high above me. I cannot reach it. Where can I go from your spirit, or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in hell, the nether world, the place of the dead, behold, you are there. If I take wings of the dawn, if I dwell in the remotest parts of the sea, come on, even there your hand will lead me and your right hand will take hold of me. Now, watch this. Somebody say, if I make my bed in hell, God will comfort me there. I don't even know what to say about that. So you can't outrun God. I'm sorry. Either you're going to conform or you're not. And if you don't, your life going to be miserable. I'm going to Africa. You'll be there when you get there. Africa going to look like Byram. It's going to look like Florence, Pilahatchee. Wherever you go, you can go to California. California going to look just like the street you live on because you there. Ain't no opportunities in Mississippi because you ain't with God. God opened doors, baby. You ain't sitting and tell me. It ain't the state. It's the state of your spirit, and it's the state of that jacked up mindset. That's the state. I'm telling you now. Give me Ezekiel, Jeremy 36 and... let's see, 20, 24, 23, 24, somewhere like that. Let's get it. Every believer, every true believer, this has happened to. So we got to start now. We got to show you why your heart shouldn't be as jacked up as it is when you first got saved, before you got saved. God said, go here. So I'm following what he told me to do. But this is for every true believer. I ain't talking about the counterfeit. You ought to have been around enough real believers to know when you're around somebody fake. And the devil gonna always say you fake because the people don't want to live right, gonna find fault. Long as you okay with God, don't matter what people say. Because people gonna find fault because your life is convicting them. Come on. But when you doing what the world do, Ezekiel 36 and 24, 25, and I'm gonna read that on out. It says, for I will take you from among the nations and gather you from all the countries and bring you into your own land. Then will I sprinkle clean water, the word of God, the gospel, the good news, and you will be clean. You are clean by the road, John 15, clean by the word which I have spoken. John 15 chapter, second verse. I will cleanse you from all your uncleanliness and from your idols. Everything that you're putting before God is an idol. If it's you, you the idol. If it's a car, if it's a job, anything you give him more time to than God is an idol. Moreover, I will give you a new heart and spirit. There it is right there. So you ain't got a jacked up heart no more. Where this hate coming from? Huh? Where that stank attitude coming from? I will give you a new heart and a spirit and put a new spirit within you. Come on, you're going too fast. Come on back down. Within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh. You ain't got a hard heart now. Why are you so difficult to deal with in your flesh and give you, come on back down, Jeff, and give you a heart of flesh? I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk. Christ, Jesus had God's spirit, the same spirit. Look how he lived. And cause you to walk in my word. My statutes is my word. And you will keep my orders and do them. So why is it so difficult to be saved if you got this? If you really a true believer, this is prophecy. This has already happened. So why is it so difficult? You want me to answer that? Why is it so difficult? Because you love what you love. When you love something, you ain't finna let it go. You're going to keep doing it. Well, that's your choice to do it now. Nobody's mad with you, but that's what you choose. Now, you're going to have to deal with all that. Because there are consequences to this stuff. I know. Because doggone it, I hate I did what I did. Lord, I hate that. But guess what? It's too late now. All I can do is learn and try to stop y'all from doing it. Well, I heard too many people today, let me make my own mistake. That's flat out rebellion. That is not no mistake. When you hear the word and you steady living fire, let me make my own. That's not a mistake. Christ didn't die for mistakes. What did he die for? Come on. And you will live in the land that I gave your fathers, and you will be my people, and I will be your God. And I will also save you from your uncleanliness, not the state. Uncleanly, not the state of Mississippi, not the sins of slavery in Mississippi, from your mess. And I will call for the grain and make it abundant. See, God going to make sure abundance happens when you come under his plan and get in his family. I will not bring famine upon you. I will multiply the fruit of your tree and produce. Look at all the abundance when you get right with God. This is what he's talking about. So that you will not suffer again the disgrace of famine among the nation. Why is it so jacked up now? So, watch this. I got this right here to validate. Jesus modeled full dependence upon the Holy Spirit, did he not? What he had inside of him. Why? Well, you got to do the same thing. Jesus came under the authority of the Holy Spirit. The Father, he was the Son, and he always agreed with God. We don't always agree with God. If you know the word, every word that you know come out that book, when are you going to start agreeing with it? Because if you don't, God ain't going to never trust you. I'm telling you what I know. Jesus modeled the centrality of prayer in his life and ministry. Do not only talk to God the Father when you want something from him. Oh, I prayed and prayer opened that door for me. Oh, I prayed and God blessed me. What? I ain't nothing wrong with that. I've done that. But the best thing I can say, what I prayed about, that changed. I prayed about me, and the prayer changed me. Prayer changing everything, opening every door, but changing the people that's praying. I got a shirt. Prayer changed the thing, and I'm the thing that it changed. You don't hear a lady say, what that mean? I say, I'm the thing that prayer changed. Number three. Jesus modeled the importance of obedience to his Father's will. What was he doing? Following the Spirit. What you modeling? Listen, as a disciple of Jesus, I said it last night and I'm going to say it again. You can confess Christ in your car, in the woods, in the closet, in the bathroom locked up, in private. But when you're going to be a disciple is a follower. It's a follower. A disciple is a follower. It's a follower. Look it up in the Greek, 31 Strong Concordance, 3101. It's a learner, a pupil, a follower of Christ who learns the doctrine of the scriptures and the lifestyle they require. Now, to be a disciple, you're going to have to be visible, verbal. Your baptism was a coming out part. I'm ready for the world to know that I'm a disciple. Everybody knew you was a sinner. They just didn't tell you. Everybody knew you was a sinner. You were verbal about it. Your life, the way you dressed, said you was a sinner. Now that you say you saved, it's time to come out. It's time to be visible and verbal. And it's time to be clear about who you signed with. I was clear about I was a Satan worshiper because I served him. It was clear. Everybody knew I wasn't saved. I went to church. That man said, "Are you saved?" I said, "Yep." He knew I was lying. That man had the spirit. He knew I was lying. So I was clear about who I was following. My life was dark. I was dark. Everything that I was involved in was dark and shady. But when I became a believer and made my mind up, I was visible and I was very verbal about the stand that I took and the candidate that I was promoting. And it's just like people now. They don't know who to vote for. They back and forth. They don't know what to do. Their mind ain't made up. They that away with God. You need to make your mind up. If you don't want God, make your mind up. But you need to be clear, because people are watching you and everybody watching you, and they pick up on your stuff and do it, God is going to hold you accountable. It's in the book. We covered that last Wednesday, didn't we? Sure did. You're going to have to give an account. So you need to be clear. It's clear you love Jackson State. It's clear you love Alcorn. It's clear you love Valley. It's clear you love Southern. That's clear. You got the flag. You got the jersey. You got the hat. But I love Jesus, but it's not visible. It ain't clear. Jesus was clear about his love for the Father. We ain't clear because one minute we love him, next minute I don't know. What made you change your mind? I don't care what happened to me from this point in my life. I have made my declaration, and I'm standing on the fact that I love Jesus until the day I leave this earth. For God I live, and for God I die. Somebody made a statement. Well, this man said that some men broke up in the place in the church talking about everybody in here love God. You're going to have to get on your knees and say, "I don't love Jesus." I said, "Bro, I haven't heard that, you know, illustration before. But the way a person live, the person already dead. You can't kill a person two times. That's what I'm dead." So if somebody come up in there shooting at me, you doing me a favor. We preach about it, but you got to die to get there. I'm not scared of dying because I know where I'm going. Now, once upon a time, before I learned who I am in him, I had some concern. I was scared of that. I ain't scared now. No. Jesus modeled the importance of obedience to his Father's will. And you're going to have to model that too. For God's word was central in Christ's life. It was the main thing. It was in the center of his life. It's just a few things right here. Brother Jeremy, so give me John 3:16. Let's go back to that, and we're going to read that out. Now, we're going to bring it to the New Testament. Now that we done had a heart transplant, we done got cleaned up. Now, here go the deal. What is a believer? I believe. But before then, let me get James. Where my Bible at? Let me get James. Since we say we believe, this is what the devil believed too. I just think a lot of people got devil faith. Well, I believe there's a God. You ain't serving him. So you really don't believe him. That your life is saying you either saved or unsaved. It ought to be clear where you stand for God. But everybody's not clear about where they are. It says here, James 2, second chapter and verse 19. You believe that God is one, and you do well to believe that. We're talking about believe now. Demons also believe that and shudder and bristle and all feel terror. They have seen his wrath. Devil know he real. And now, are they serving the church? Are they helping us build up the kingdom? Huh? Are they giving you strength to serve God? Them demons, are they there to help you win souls? Huh? Huh? Are the devils helping you to win souls? No. So, if you got devil faith, God knows it's devil faith. Only way you can have faith in God based on what he said. That's how you get faith. Come on, Jerry. Now, let's look. For God so greatly loved and dearly prized the world that he even gave his one and only begotten son so that whosoever believe and trust in him as Savior, is this not the, classic. This is not the classic, is it? No, because it has cling to. This is this one right here. I want to pull them adjectives out of there. Because if you believe, that means you trust. You do what you believe every day. You do what you believe every day. You don't believe in bathing, you ain't bathing. You don't believe in combing your hair, you're not going to comb your hair. You believe in have going to work, you're going to have go to work. Here we go. So God greatly loved and dearly prized. Now, the Amplified Bible gives you the Greek. We get in the Greek derivatives. Everything you see in here, unique, only begotten means unique son. Jesus was unique. So that whoever believes in, trust in, cling to. Now, when you believe, you become one with what you believe. Now, how many of you really believe in God? So if you believe in God, that means you becoming one with this. This moves you. If you, everything that the Father said moved Jesus. His word governed Jesus' action. So if you say you believe in God and his word is not causing you to go in a certain direction, he's not your Lord and Savior. Well, if Jesus ain't your master or Lord, then his word ain't going to mean nothing to you. You're going to do what you want to do and do what you want to do. Why is it so hard for me? You know the answer. You know the answer. Come on, we trying to get this right. We got to get this right. If we're going to be the church to be what God wants us to be in 2020 and for the rest, 22 and on through life, then we got to trust. Believe means to trust. Do we trust God or do we trust ourselves? That's mess. That's bookie. Cling to. That means become one. Didn't the Bible say a man and wife shall cling, man shall leave his mother and father and cling unto his wife, and they two shall become one? God said, I want you one with me, thinking like me, acting like me. Rely on him, shall not perish, but come to destruction. And come to destruction and be lost, but have eternal life. This is how you get eternal life, because you believe, you trust in the word of God. You live it. All right? For God did not send his son into the world in order to judge, to reject, to condemn, or pass sentence on the world. We got to get there. But that the world might find salvation and be made safe and sound through who? Steve Harvey says only 800 ways. I'm sorry. I don't listen to Steve Harvey. I don't listen to nobody who got money who want to live a sinful life and think they're going to be saved too. It don't work like that. It don't work like that. But you can't tell these people nothing. Whoever believe in him, listen, who clings to, trust in, and rely on him is not judged. So what area you don't trust him in, that's the area you judged in. What, God just wants you to believe in him to go to heaven? You don't believe that you can overcome that? You don't believe that you can live right and stop cussing, stop being mean, and have an attitude? Let this attitude that was in Jesus be in who? Amen. So we got some work to do. And we acting like we got everything, and there's some work. If you ain't putting the work in, let me say this. And I'm scared of people who say they saved and they're not working on themselves. That's an accident waiting to happen. Satan, will you turn the people against you? I know he will. I done seen it happen. Let me say this. When you make your mind up to really give your life to Jesus Christ, you know who's going to come against you? I'm going to say Christian, as they say. Because the Christian love the world. And they don't really want you to give up the world and go with Christ, because they're going to resent you too for making that decision. A lot of people are going to come against you for living the way God wants you to live. And the church is going to be the biggest obstacle you're going to have to overcome. How do I know that? I tell anybody, if you ain't serious about God, go on back out there and play. But I'd rather have you lost in here than out there. The woman lost some, that one coin. She got some gifts, a gift. 10 coins came into a wedding set. She lost one. That was a parable. The woman took the light and searched the house. What's the light? Word. And found it. And she went all around. Rejoice with me. I found that one coin. So Jesus said heaven rejoices over one sinner than over 99. I'm telling you, God is not responsible for people going to hell. And preachers not either, because you got a Bible. You can read it for yourself. Listen, he who believes in him, cling to, trust, and rely on him is not judged. So you can't be judged. There is no condemnation, Romans 8:1. See? You can't be judged when you're becoming one with the word. You use the word. You're learning how to allow the word to govern every decision. See, if the word ain't changing your decision, you ain't making decision off the word of God, you ain't a disciple yet. You got to train to be a disciple. The word of God got to change your mind, govern decisions, how you raise your kids, who you marry, who you don't marry, what you believe and what you don't believe. Come on. The word of God does all that. And say, he who trusts in him never comes up for judgment. For him, there is no rejection, no condemnation. He incurs no damnation. But he who does not believe, all right, Jesus is telling you, you don't cleave to. Believe. You don't believe because you don't cleave to. And you don't rely on or trust him. You rely on your smarts. You rely on what your friend said. You're judged already. You got to rely on this. If you don't, you already judged. I didn't write it. You already judged. You already judged. They go for me from the pulpit to the door. I believe everything written in here because I wouldn't be where I'm at now if I did. If I didn't believe it. This word works. This word done cast out demons. People done got healed by this word. People done got healed through me. And I didn't do it. God did it. It's too many, I done got too many results off the word of God to be sitting there playing. You can be doing something else tonight. Now, I tell people, don't go to hell by the way of the church. You're going to go. Be clear about who you represent. Because God already knows. That's what we're talking about. This is, I went from giving you a good heart, right spirit. So we got everything we need to believe this right? Didn't he say I'm going to put a spirit in you to cause you to obey this? All right, this is why we're here. That ain't us. We got the right spirit. We got the right heart. For him, there's no rejection. Condemnation, he occurs. No damnation. But he who does not believe, if you ain't doing it, you don't believe. I don't care who you are. You could be my mama. My mama didn't get saved to the end. They're my biggest obstacle. My mama. My brother, the devil got in my family, and there was a bigger one. You think I care? I never got along with him when I was growing up. I stayed away from him because I knew I was different. But God was preparing me for ministry because Jesus didn't have, Jesus wasn't there. Jesus wasn't liked. And if you really follow God, people ain't going to like you either. You want to be like you in the wrong business. Listen, who does not believe, cleave to, rely on, trust him, is judged already. He has already been convicted, has already received his sentence because you have already went to court and you already been sentenced. He has not believed and trusted in the name of the only begotten, the Son of God. He is condemned for refusing to let his trust rest in Christ's name. You already sentenced to hell. Because you don't believe. You ain't doing it. I didn't write that. Come on, Jeff. Now, Jesus finna tell us why this is. Now, the basis of the judgment, the indictment, the test by which men are judged, the ground for the sentence lies in this. This is why the gavel been hit on you. Who is the judge? Jesus. The light has come into the world. And people love rather than and more than the light. Who is the light of the world? As long as I'm in the world, I'm the light of the world. For their works, deeds were evil. What's the basis of you being sentenced to hell? Because you love darkness more than you love the light. It's obvious. It's clear that you love darkness. It's clear that you love light. This ain't no rocket science. Everybody see it. We can see it and tell where everybody at. This ain't no. Now, the Bible said don't judge yourself by yourself because who the standard? Christ is the standard. So if we ain't looking like Christ, we got work to do. We got work to do. Jesus modeled obedience. He modeled prayer. What didn't he model? He modeled everything. So what's the problem? Didn't he give us a heart to obey? Didn't he give us a heart to obey? He cut the old heart out and gave you a heart of flesh so you can obey. So it's your choice to do it or not to do it. But when judgment come upon you and these demons start attacking you, then you're going to wonder why. Don't wonder why. You know why. You know why. Come on. Listen, for every wrongdoer hates, loathes, detests, put Jesus there because he's the light. I will not come out, listen, and will not come out into the light, but shrinks from it, least his works. This is how you identify his work, his deeds, his activity, his conduct, be exposed and reproved. Come on. But he who practices truth, who does what is right, comes into the light, so his works may be plainly shown to be what they are. Wrought with God, divinely prompted, done with God's help, in dependence upon him. Come on. Do y'all see this? So, Jeremy, give me gather myself. Give me Psalm 51. Give me Psalm 51. Now, did God give you initial at the birth, at confessing, a clean heart? This is what you don't need to do right here. And I've heard somebody pray this prayer. I told them, you're praying the wrong prayer. David prayed that. You can't pray this. Watch this. Psalm 51, verse 9. I'm going to get 10 with it. 10 is what I want, but this is David. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my guilt and iniquity. Create in me a clean heart. He did that. He gave you that when you confessed it. What? Pull off the old man. Your job is to keep it clean. Now, he ain't better. You can't ask God for that. That's on you. Is it not? Come on. Give me, creating me a clean heart. He gave you a heart that is willing to obey and that will walk and do the commandments and renew a right, persevering and steadfast spirit within me. He already gave you the same spirit Jesus had. So, Jeremy, give me Ephesians 4:20, and we're going to read on down. So, if he already gave you a heart that's willing to obey, why won't you? Then he said, let not your heart be troubled. You let it not be troubled. God ain't finna do that. That's your job. Go to the hospital, Lord. Go here, Lord. Go help my neighbor, Lord. Well, God said, I'll go if you go. I need a body. Listen, but you did not so learn Christ, assuming that you have really heard him and been taught by him, as all truth is in Jesus, embodied and personified in him. Strip off of your, what? Strip yourselves. What you do? Strip it, God. You can't pray creating me a clean heart. Strip yourself of your former nature. Put off and disregard your old renewed self, characterized by your previous manner of life, and become corrupt through lust and desires that spring from delusion. You're delusional. And be constantly renewed in the spirit of your mind, having a fresh and mental spiritual attitude. How do you do that? Jeremy, hold on. Put on the new man. God ain't finna do that. Put on the new nature. Regenerated, the regenerated self created in God's image, God likeness and true righteousness and holy. And listen, this is what you got to do if you want to keep that heart clean and therefore reject all falsity being done with it. Let everyone express the truth with his neighbor, for we are all parts of one body and members of one another. I've seen people love to tell people the truth, but when you tell them the truth, they get angry. That's crazy. Where did I say we going next? I was thinking of a scripture. Put that back up there. I'm trying to think, where do we need to go from here? Okay, leave no such room for a foothold for the devil. What? Uh-uh. Rag on now. Come on. When angry, do not let sin, do not ever let your wrath, your aspiration, your fury, or indignation last till the sun go down. Immature people do this all the time. ain't never went to bed unsettled on what God said. I might have not settled it with the person, but it was settled with me because I already knew what God said. Leave no such room or a foothold for the devil. How many times have you gave the devil a foothold because you wasn't sorry? Huh? Well, you did it. Let the thief steal no more, but rather let him be industrious, making an honest living with his own hands so that he may be able to do what? Buy up everything he need. Give who? Give who? So you ain't just working for you. You got to help other people and mainly help the people that can't do nothing for you. Watch this. Let no foul, polluted language, nor evil word, nor unwholesome word, wholesome or worthless talk ever come out of your mouth. Give me some worthless and unwholesome talk. Make an example. Anybody. Come on. I'm depressed. And God listening at you, what? You got the right spirit in you. What's the problem? I ain't working on myself. I ain't renewing my mind. Yeah, five, Jeremy. We talking about attitude. Let's go to Matthew 5, please. Yeah, attitude. So this is if you're going to be a follower, this your mouth tells me what kind of foundation you're on. As a follower of Christ, the anointed, our spiritual foundation is vital to our life in Christ. As a follower of Satan. Your spiritual foundation, because it's unspiritual, unholy, is vital to your life in Satan. Why are you reading that? Because there's two sides of every coin. How is it that we were that committed to the devil? And I said it last night. What else God got to do to wow you, prove to you that he's going to be faithful to you? For you to give up everything. Why don't you surrender to him? Why don't you? Oh, if I can just get the right job, if I can get the right man or the right woman. Ain't no Mr. Right, ain't no Mrs. Right. I remember when we were teaching on marriage class, and I gave an illustration because this really happened. Some men joined the church. They know nothing about God. And I heard them say, take off your hood, the boy, Jairie. Spiritually. And there go your hood. Like, will you let him grow? Or you jack him up? What Jairie gonna do? Man, that's just about what their spirit is. They ain't know nothing about Jesus. They know nothing about the love of God. Talking about that your hood. But leave that man alone. Never seen nothing like that. Talking about there go your hood. What? He don't know Jesus. He got to learn how to live for God. It's going to take some years, and you ain't ready to wait. Did I say something wrong? No, God heard. That ain't what you need to know who God is in a relationship. See, in the crowd, he went up on the mount, and when he was set, his disciples came to him. His what? Disciples. His disciples. We talking about followers of Christ. Then he opened his mouth and taught them. Blessed to be envied and spiritual prosperous with life, joy, satisfaction in God's favor and salvation, regardless of their outward condition. And the poor are the poor in spirit, the humble who rate themselves insignificant, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. This is the attitude God wants you to have. Don't think you all that. Don't think you better than somebody. And I find that most prevalent in the body of Christ. People want to be more than what they are. You can be that. This is what I do. I'd rather serve a pastor, an apostle, a deacon, a minister, an evangelist, and believers, a number of servants. That's all we are. That's it. And I'm seeing too many people want to be more than somebody else. If somebody can do it better than you. When I was playing sports, I was always, growing up, one of the better ones on the team. But I tried to make everybody around me better. Coach said, you the best, help these guys hit, catch. And then as a pastor, I try to help people get like me. But I found out throughout my life, a lot of people don't want what I got. They don't want to put the work in. They want to go pro, but they don't want to put the work in. Do you know to go pro, you're going to have to be criticized, told you ain't doing it right. You're going to have to get up when everybody else want to get up. You're going to have to go over and beyond. This stuff got to be like breathing you. Everybody want it, but everybody ain't willing to put the work in. I was a diligent sinner, blessed and envied with happiness produced by the experience of God's favor. What this happiness is produced by? This is spiritual happiness, not what the world give you based on what's happening, you happy. Then when things ain't going right, you looking crazy. No. This is produced by the Holy Spirit right here. Of God's favor, especially conditioned by the revelation of his matchless grace, those who mourn, they shall be comforted. This is the attitude that Jesus is teaching these guys. Blessed, happy, blitzum, joyful, spiritual, prosper with life, joy, satisfaction in God's favor and salvation regardless of their outward condition. It don't matter what it looks like. The meek, the mild, the patient, the long-suffering, for they shall inherit the earth. Blessed and fortunate. And then Jesus said, all power was given unto me in heaven and earth. How did he get it? That's who he was. Bag that back down. That's Jesus right there. That's him. Mild, patient, long-suffering. Did he inherit earth? All authority and power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Blessed, fortunate, happy, spiritual, prosperous in the state which is born again, child of God, enjoys his favor and salvation are those who hunger and thirst after wrongdoing and upright and right standing with God, for they shall be completely satisfied. You know why a lot of people ain't satisfied? Because they ain't right with God. You get right with God, you ain't gonna be satisfied. You ain't gonna be unsatisfied, because you will be content till God open the next door. God will open that next door for you if you prove to be lonesome, because God is gonna test you. I done flunked a lot of tests, so I know when you flunk. Haven't I told you I was a dunk spiritually? I flunked to learn how not to flunk. Jesus, what did he say? The things he learned obedience through the things he suffered. Keep living. You get it right. Because you're going to suffer. And it ain't because you're going through for Jesus. You're suffering because you won't obey. Blessed, happy to be envied, spiritual, prosperous with life and joy, satisfaction, God's favor and salvation, regardless of their outward condition, are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. These are the attitudes Jesus is telling the disciples they must have if you're going to be a follower of me. How many times have you run across that in people? How many times have God allowed you to see that attitude in people? He always let it come out while you're around other saints. He always. So what is God doing? Jeremy, give me Revelation 2 and 23, please. Revelation 2 and 26. So, as a follower of Christ, our spiritual foundation is vital. How strong is your foundation? How strong is your faith or the word that you believe? That's how strong your foundation is. If you don't know but three scriptures, you ought to be living them three scriptures. You ought to be able to tell somebody them three scriptures that should have been produced something in your life. The revelation without a manifestation is a missed opportunity. God revealed something to you, and that word should have changed that area of your life. Now you can tell somebody and got testimony what that word did in that area, and then when God add to it, then you trust that word, and your foundation is being built. So your foundation is only as strong as the word you believe. Now, do you really believe? Because you're going to be tested. Where you at there? What is this? Huh? Revelation 23. Revelation 2 and 23. Revelation 2 and 23. And I will strike her children, her proper followers, dead, thoroughly examining them. And all the assembly churches shall recognize and understand that I am he who searches mind, the thoughts, feelings, and purpose, and the innermost heart, and I will give to each of you the reward for what you have done as your work deserves. good or bad. Jezebel's children are going down. And the church going to get rewarded. That attitude you won't let go of, oh, you're going to get rewarded for. That mean spirit and not loving and not forgiving. God forgave you. You got to be quick to forgive. You want to get on the wrong side of God? Hold a grudge on somebody. See what happens. And God done forgave you. Come on now. You can't do that. Come on. Amen. Now, we're going to stop. Give me 1 Samuel 6 and 7. 1 Samuel 6 and 7. So, when you ask God to search you, you already know what's there. You mean to tell me everything that we done talked, you don't know what's there? I ain't bad as her. She ain't the standard. God is. I'm better than Sister Bench. I'm better than Bruh Lightbug. Well, they ain't the standard. God is. Don't look at people. Because when I look in the mirror, I see me. I see me. Now then, make and prepare a new cart. And this is 1 Samuel 16 and verse 7. First Samuel 16, verse 7. Search me, O Lord. This is the prayer for every believer. We must be always be aware that there may be something in us that grieves God. Well, you ever know people, they get on my nerve. Don't you know you might get on God's nerve? Huh? But the Lord said to Samuel, look not on his appearance or the height of his stature, for I have rejected him. For the Lord seeth not as man see it. For man looks on the outward appearance. Ooh, they look so good on the outside, but their spirit is jacked up. God see the spirit. You better look at people for what they are. If their mouth is foul, their heart is foul. If their mouth is pleasant, it's because their spirit is pleasant. For I have rejected him, for the Lord sees not as man. For a man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart, the spirit. God sees your spirit. He sees your spirit. Ain't it funny how we try to act all nice in the right place? Ain't nobody that nice. I'll tell anybody. Ain't nobody that nice. 1 Chronicles 28, verse 9. 1 Chronicles chapter 28, verse 9. The faithful are those who take God's word to heart. They keep God's steadfast love, God's word, before their eyes and walk in his statutes. Those are the ones who love God. If you love me, obey me. You and you, Solomon, my son, God, know the God of your father. Have personal knowledge of him. Why do everybody want to know the word but don't want to live it? The word ain't to win theological arguments. It is to live and change your life, change your community, change your job. Have personal knowledge of him. Be acquainted with him and understand him. Appreciate, heed, and cherish him. Do we cherish him? And serve him with a blameless heart. How do you do that? How do you do that? And a willing mind. Are we willing? For the Lord searches all the heart and mind and understand all the wonderings of the thought. How many times people be sitting up in there and their mind ain't nowhere here? Don't you know God know it and I know it too? Let me say this. When a preacher is up preaching the word of God, when people really want the word, the spirit in the people pulls it out. It's just like siphoning gas. You ever siphon gas? When you get it going, how it flows out. When somebody really wants the word, it flows out of me to those people. And I done been in places where they just sitting there. And I had to stop, couldn't preach. They didn't want it. I know when somebody wants it and when they don't. That's why y'all used to hear me say, I ain't talking to anybody. That's why I said that. I say stuff for a reason. I don't just be talking just to be talking. So it says here, if you seek him, if you seek him, inquire for him, and of him, and requiring him as your first and vital necessity. So you know when God first, when his word changed your direction of your life. When what he says carries weight with you. That's when you know you're a disciple in training and when he's first in your life. But when God's word you hear it and it don't, you ain't no disciple and he ain't first in your life. You might be a Christian, but you ain't a disciple yet. If you seek him and inquire for him and of him require and of him and require him as your first and vital necessity, you will find him. But if you forsake him, he will cast you off forever. Well, you sold it, right? God is merciful. God won't do that. Lord have mercy. One more. Well, a couple of more. We got 28. Give me 2 Chronicles 16 and 9. And write this down. 2 Chronicles 16 and 9. Did we get that? We got 28 and 9. Then. And we're going to get Psalms 26, 2 and verse 3. I want everybody in here to grow. I want my wife, God, I was telling my wife today, he said, teach. God reminded me, teach her. And I constantly go over my head, train her and teach her. And I'm training her. I'm a teacher. And I told her, it's going to be all right. You got the Spirit of God in you. You just need to really take your time, look over this stuff, and I'll tell her, preach this word to yourself. Preach it to you, because I preach it to me. I always preach the word. That's why I like working in the yard, because I'm ministering. The Holy Spirit is ministering to my spirit. Amen. If you don't want it, and I tell people, if you don't want to hear it from your pastor, then read it for yourself. You're a believer, right? Well, won't you believe what you say? Since the preacher ain't right. Well, since I ain't right, anybody don't want to listen to me, then put voice to it. The Lord said, he who searched for me with all my heart shall be found. But if I reject him, he's going to reject me. So you'll believe it if you read it and hear yourself reading it, right? Your word can't wait, right? Since I ain't no good. Just make an illustration. I told somebody that before. For the eyes of the Lord run where? Through, to and fro. That's in and out throughout the whole earth. To show himself strong in the behalf of those whose heart, that spirit, are blameless toward him. How do you be blameless? Everybody know this. Ephesians 4, it says, speaking the truth in love. All right, how do you be blameless? In love. In love. You're blameless when you love. You can't be condemned when you love everybody. But if you ain't got love in your heart, you ain't gonna never be blameless. Love covers a multitude of fault. That's how you be blameless with God. Loving and forgiving everybody. It's in the book. If I'm not mistaken, hold on, let me see. I think there's Romans 5. Let me find it. If I'm not mistaken. This is Amplified. I think it's from the King James. But I do know, how do you be blameless? In love. You can't be condemned walking in love. No way. No way. How did Jesus do it? Walking in love. Amen. Come on. For your loving kindness is before my eyes, and I have walked in your truth faithfully. I do not sit with false person, nor fellowship with pretenders. Do you? Do you? I hate the company of evildoers and will not sit with the wicked. Do you? Do you? I will wash my hands in innocence and go about your altar, O Lord, that I will make the voice of thanksgiving and may tell of your wondrous works. All right. What did I say? We got Psalms 26, 2 and 3, and we're going to close. So, Jesus modeled intention, relationship of love and integrity throughout his life. And we must follow him and do the same thing. Come on. Examine me, O Lord. Prove me. Test my heart. Oh, he is. He is. Let me say this. The areas that you have grown in, and you think you done got that, God will retest you in the marriage to see if you're going to stay obedient there. Because if he don't, you're going to think that's okay since you ain't doing it. But if you slip back and go there, God is showing you. You can't go back. We're going forward. We're going forward. Come on. Come on. Examine me, O Lord. Prove and test me. Test my heart and my mind. For your loving kindness is before me. And my eyes have I walked in your truth faithfully. And this is what we got to do. One more, Jeremy. Jeremiah 7 and 24. And we close. So, here we did. Now, all this that we talked about tonight, showing you what kind of foundation you on. How strong is your foundation? How faithful and obedient you are to God's word and submitting to God's wisdom enables you to build a solid foundation of biblical truth and remain steadfast because we have been strengthened inward by trusting in our faithful God who is always true to his word. Now, if you don't trust his word, what do you have? Who created the world? God. How did he do it? With his word. How did he put the stars there? He put it there with words. So you're going to have to trust his word if you're going to be on a solid foundation. If you ain't, man, that's on you. Come on. But they would not listen to obey me or bend their ears to me, but follow the counsel of the stubborn prompting of their own and mine. And they turned their backs and went in reverse. Don't ever think you at a standstill. Mississippi ain't hitting on that. That ain't what it is. Put that back up there. That's what it is right there. That's what it is right there. Right there. Listen, they wouldn't obey. They wouldn't follow the counsel. They wouldn't obey God. But they listening to somebody. If you're not obeying God, you're obeying somebody. It ain't for God and the devil. But follow the counsel. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor sitteth in the seat of the... But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and does he meditate. Psalm 1. And the stubborn prompting of their own... What did he say? What did God say? Their own evil hearts and mind. And they turned their back on God and went in reverse instead of forward. How many people you see in reverse? Who fought it? Jackson, Mississippi. Chuckway. Kenny Stokes. Who fought it? It's your own fault. You know enough words to have a blessed life starting tonight. If you choose to obey. All is well when you obey. All is wrong when you don't. So it's your choice. Everything that you know and have heard, God gonna hold you accountable for it. Just like he do me. God is holding me accountable for everybody in this church. I got to give an account. And guess what? I'm okay with that. All right, that's our lesson for tonight. Thank you.